Penguin Random House Canada presents The Suspect by L. R. Wright. Read for you by Peter Outerbridge, Kristin Kreuk, and John Nelles. This book is for my brother, Brian Appleby.
1. He was a very old man. When he was struck, he fell over promptly, without a sound. His chair made a sound, a twisted squeak of a noise, but it let him go, made no move that George could see to clasp its wooden arms around him, hold him close to its padded back, keep him firmly upright upon its padded seat. It just gave a small squeak as its rockers skewed frantically on the polished hardwood floor. Then it righted itself, gently rocked back into serenity, and was finally motionless and silent. Everything was silent then, silent in the silent sunshine. Yet George had an impression of uproar and consternation. There was a thundering in his 80-year-old heart, a feebleness in his antiquated knees. His body had become a horrified, garrulous commentator on calamity. He did a slow, backward shuffle, his eyes still fixed on the empty rocking chair, and lowered himself carefully onto the Chesterfield, his right hand wrapped around a cylindrical piece of brass that had once been a shell casing. He pushed himself back on the Chesterfield and let his head rest against its flowered slipcover. Then he sat up to take a large white handkerchief from his pocket and spread it on the maple coffee table next to a vase of peonies, robustly pink. He set the shell casing carefully on top of the white fabric square. He saw that there was blood on the sleeve of his V-necked navy cardigan. He leaned back and closed his eyes. He was surprised that his mind was so calm. He decided that his heart must be the font of whatever wisdom he possessed. It was still a place of bedlam, racketing in revulsion at Carlyle lying still and dead, half his face buried in the braided rug, bleeding neatly, discreetly, there instead of onto the hardwood floor. But after a while, even his heart became serene. George realized that he was going to survive this astonishing thing. He reached out and picked up the shell casing. It had a pattern of quarter-inch dots all over it, and up one side was embossed a voluptuous urn holding a single large flower. He couldn't identify what kind of flower it was supposed to be. It had 13 petals, he counted them, and 2 large leaves protruded from its stem. He wondered if Carlyle had had this peculiar decoration imposed upon the shell casing, or if it had come like that from wherever he got it. George studied this object, his weapon, wonderingly. It was a foot high and hollow, about 7 inches in diameter at the base, tapering to a little less than 5 inches at the top. A kind of rim was formed at the base by an indentation etched all the way around, about 1/8 of an inch from the bottom. He thought it remarkable that it wasn't even dented. Maybe skulls got frailer as bodies aged, he thought, and brought his left hand up to touch cautiously the top of his head. There was blood on the base and bits of tissue or something. Maybe it was brain, thought George, detached, as he set the shell casing back on top of his handkerchief. He didn't like feeling so emotionless. Yet it was a relief, too, just as Carlyle's silence was a relief. They'd probably have to lock him up immediately, thought George. He was sure there wasn't any bail for murderers, and he didn't plan to explain himself either, which wouldn't help. He was curious about prison. They might put him in one of those new-fashioned places where you had a room instead of a cell and got to read and eat half-decent meals. He nodded to himself, thinking, becoming more and more certain that they wouldn't put a person of his advanced age into a maximum security facility. It might be quite an interesting experience, jail. No gardens there, though. There was some blood on the front of his sweater, too, he noticed. It ought to make him feel sick or panicky, but it didn't. He was quite tranquil. He remembered his daughter, Carol, asking when she was very young if he had ever been in jail. He had assured her vehemently that he had not, but her question had shaken him badly. He remembered that she'd been surprised and disappointed by his reply. She'd gotten the idea from somewhere that all men went to jail now and then. George had worried about their brief conversation for a long time. He tried to imagine now her adult reaction to his arrest and incarceration, and flinched. He deserved it, no question about that. But he saw the irony in it, and Carol, of course, would not. Carlisle's living room was drenched in sunshine. His body lay in it. The hardwood floor gleamed in it. There was a disquieting permanence in these moments, George thought. He was sure the sun would continue to shine steadily through the big window at precisely this angle. He was sure the earth had ceased its perambulations at last and come to rest forever at this specific point in its axis. George continued to rest on the Chesterfield, hands on his knees, and felt himself blinking stupidly at the sunshine, at the rocking chair, at the tall cabinet across the room which held the collection of china. There was no horror in the room, no disapproval. There was only the benign sunshine and the radiance of polished wood. The act of murder had apparently been swiftly absorbed, dispensed with. Even George's own body had adjusted to what it had done. This didn't seem proper. Something judgmental ought to be happening. But the soporific sun shone in, illuminating Carlisle lying there dead with no more emphasis than it shed upon the rocking chair, or the brass-based lamp on the end table, or George's hands resting on his knees. The man was dead. There was no doubt about it. There was an incontrovertible sense of absence in his stillness. George looked vaguely around the room and continued to sit quietly, waiting for some feeling to claim him. But nothing claimed him. Nothing choked his chest, not remorse or self-satisfaction. He was empty of all things important. He thought back to the moments of the murder. He could remember each second clearly, but the seconds didn't accumulate neatly in his mind to form a definable experience. He shouldn't have come here. He hadn't been in this house for months, and he certainly shouldn't have come today. He couldn't remember what Carlisle had said to persuade him. He couldn't remember walking here, but he remembered arriving. The front door was ajar. On either side of the concrete steps, wide and shallow, was a pot of lemon-scented geranium. They were terracotta pots. The door was ajar. Carlisle had a habit of doing things like that, leaving his doors and windows open for any bright-eyed burglar to get through. When he drove a car, he had never locked it and had often left his keys in the ignition. He was never robbed and announced this often. "Never been robbed," he would say proudly. "Never. Trust people, that's my motto." His left eye would close then. He probably thought he looked droll, winking like that. But to George, he only looked like he had a left eye that wasn't reliable anymore. Never been robbed, thought George, sitting on the flowered Chesterfield, and now he's been murdered. Carlisle had droned on and on from his rocking chair, looking out the window at the sea. When George finally realized what he was leading up to, he tried to stop him. He tried very hard to stop him. But Carlisle put up his hand and shook his head and went right on talking. At some point, George started to leave, but Carlyle said, "I'm talking about your sister, George. Your family." He turned around to smile at him. "Pay some respect, George. Pay some attention." It was the smile, that mocking, knowing smile which held George planted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.